stand as you're able for the first praise song.
White with foam. God bless America, my home, sweet home. God bless America, my home, sweet home.
Such a showboat.
Good morning, church.
You may be seated. What a rousing welcome for our worship service. Thank you. I appreciate that. We're glad you all could be here. I'm Pastor Gary Rideout, one of the co-senior pastors here at this church, along with my wife, Jane, who will be presenting the message today. We're glad you're here. We're glad you have you all those who are on live stream from wherever you're at, from home or on vacation. We're glad that you're joined us too. Just have really one announcement for you today. That is the blood mobile. The blood drive is going to be next Sunday, July 14th. So here you see, it's from 8:30 to 1:30. You don't have to make an appointment. Just come on in, and just hope that you put that on your calendar for next week. I do want to say there's a couple of things you just closed ended this week. We're very excited about Family Promise. That's an organization where we work with other churches to house families that are on the brink of being homeless. That just ended this morning. I saw them cleaning out, taking the beds out this morning to go to another church. And it was just a very wonderful week. A lot of volunteers for that week. We've had people delivering foods and playing with the kids and spending the night with them. And just to think that there were two families. One of them was like seven kids and five kids. Patty's saying yes, so I think that was right. But just to think that, where would those people have gone if we went for Family Promise? So we're thankful for Family Promise. And then also a group from Zambia, a medical mission team, had just got back yesterday. And I talked to Cindy Parsons this morning. He said they ministered to 900 kids while they were there. Isn't that amazing? So we're just thankful for them to be back and glad to hear about, pretty soon to hear about all the stories about the Zambia trip. So before we go to greet time, this is hymn sing, and we're going to have Janet come up and ask for your hymn numbers.
Okay, now you know how it goes. You have to raise your hand, and we're, yes. 314 in the garden, okay. And I know Ed.
717:1-4.
He's specific. Yes.
110.
110. I don't recognize that number. You're trying to stump the choir director, aren't you? No. Okay. Yes. Right here. 707. Hymn of Promise. I love that one. Anybody else and anybody online, if you do not know the number of the hymn, please just say a few words and I'll try to figure it out. Yes. 384. Okay, I think that's all we're going to have for today. So just keep those numbers in mind. Judy, keep that number in mind for next week. We have three more weeks. So I will let you know at the end of the service how we're doing this. Okay. Oh, please stand now and greet each other.
Wait a second.
We are very excited today to have a baptism at this service. And so if you all would take your seats, even the family. I don't know, you can come up. So we're going to ask the mother, Brittany, and the grandma, Suzanne. Suzanne worked many years at our preschool, so you probably recognize this face. And this is Emerson.
So we are happy that family and friends are here as well to support little Emerson in her baptism. And Veronica and her family are online. We're so happy that we have technology that you can join us even when you are not here. So hopefully you can see her beautiful dress, and we're glad that you're joining us as well. So now we have some questions for you. I'll step over here, and Gary will do the questions.
Okay, these are the traditional questions of the United Methodist Church. Do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? If so, say, I do. Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression, whatever forms they present themselves? As so say, I do. Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in his grace, and promise to serve him as your Lord in union with the church, which Christ has opened to all people of all ages, nations, and races? If so say, I do. And will you nurture Emerson in Christ's holy church, that by your teaching and example, she may be guided to accept God's grace for herself, to profess her faith openly and lead a Christian life? Or so say, I will. Okay.
So I have the honor of praying and asking God to bless the water, which we will baptize little Emerson with. So will you join me in prayer? Loving God, pour out your spirit upon this gift of water and make it be for us this cleansing, refreshing water that does a spiritual work in her life, that binds her to you in the family of God, that she may have the Holy Spirit residing in her, and that she will have all the spiritual gifts that go with that, that she will know you and will feel your love and your guidance throughout her lifetime. Thank you for this gift that you offer to all of us freely, and we thank you for this precious little baby who is blessing her family. May she be a child of God. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Okay, I get to hold this little girl. Hi, sweetie. Now, she's got the dress with the smocking. I don't know about you guys, but I love the smocking. So you can kind of see her here. Look at how beautiful she is. Oh, love the bow. Yes, look at all those people. All right. What name is given this little girl?
Emerson Elaine Gravina.
Thank you. Okay, here we go. Emerson Elaine Verlita, we baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. May the Holy Spirit work within you that being born of water and the Spirit, you may always be a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Father God, pour out your Spirit upon Emerson. May she know you. May she love you. May she feel your help and your comfort and your presence throughout her life. And we thank you, Father God, for family, for a mom and a grandma and family that will surround her and support her, that she will have you and so much support of her family to raise her in the faith. We thank you and we praise you for this precious little girl. In Jesus' name, amen. Gary, you're up now.
Well, Brittany and Suzanne, answer the questions of faith for Emerson, but even though Emerson looks like a bright little girl, we don't think she's ready to answer them yet. So, and then they promise to raise her in a Christian faith until that time comes when she can answer for herself. But we want to help her, right? We want to help her raise this child in the Christian faith. So I say, members of the household of faith, I commend to your love. And I commend to your love and care this child whom this day recognize as members of the family of God. Will you endeavor so to live that Emerson may grow in the knowledge and love of God through our Savior Jesus Christ? With God's help, we will so order our lives after the example of Christ that Emerson, surrounded by steadfast love, may be established in the faith and confirmed and strengthened in the way that leads to life eternal.
Amen. All right, you also get to participate with a song, and we're going to sing the Emerson, and I'll walk her so you can see her. But you can kind of take it away, Janet.
Emerson, Emerson, God claims you. God helps you, protects you, and loves you too. We this day do all agree, a child of God you'll always be. Emerson, Emerson, God claims you. God helps you, protects you, and loves you too.
Sorry.
Okay. Please stand as you are able for the hymn.
At this time, we enter a time of prayer, and I want to make a couple of prayer concerns lifted up to you at this time. Robert McMurrian, who's a longtime member of this church and had been recently helping with our Meals on Wheels on Tuesday, he passed away actually on the 4th of July. And so we want to keep his family in our prayers. They decided not to have a service, that was their wishes. So just keep their family, Michaela, and their whole family in your prayers. Also, we've been praying for QB Gardner, who was a family. Their family usually sat back here when they came, but he had a horrible accident with his foot. They had to amputate his foot, and then he had some heart concerns that they were dealing with. Well, he's been in hospital for a long time. He went home yesterday, so we are just thankful of that. We just pray for his continued healing. So now let's go to the Lord in prayer. Let us begin with a moment of silent prayer at the prayer rail is open for anyone who wants to come forward. Gracious Holy Father, let us feel your presence in this time together. Let us be open to allow you to enter into our lives, to free us from all fears, to give us strength to carry on, to give us hope and joy sufficient for the day. Give us power to be your church. Fill your many gifts to our members that we may be the body of Christ's presence in the world. Renew our life together. Bind us closer together that we may rejoice with one another's joys and weep with one another's sorrows. Lord, we are distressed by those among us that are hurting or dejected. We pray for those who are in the midst that are grieving the loss of someone dear to them. We especially pray for the family of Robert McMurrian, who passed away the past 4th of July. May you bring comfort and mercy to their grieving hearts. We pray for those who are ailing in the hospital or at home. May you have mercy on them, and may they be filled with healing in their brokenness. In the midst of joy that fills so many of our lives, we feel sorrow and stress, pain and fear around us, and know that your grace and love are the only sufficient comfort for our lives. Bind us together, all of Christ's people around this community and the world. Help us to not be so quick to throw up dividing walls between us and those who disturb us. Help us to see that all people are your creation, your children. We seek you that all may be one in Christ, the source of all true unity, who is with us today and always, even to the end of time. For we pray this prayer in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
We are going to move now into a time of giving, but first I want to tell you about something. 2 weeks from today will be Mission Sunday. That'll be July 21st. It'll have just ended Vacation Bible School during the week, and then we do a celebration on that Sunday. And what that means, we will be in the courtyard for a party. But you need to listen carefully, because this group, it's a little different for you. The party is from 9 until 11:30. And so that means if you want to enjoy all the fellowship and the party and to get to visit all the mission tables, you will need to come a little early on July 21st, okay? Because by 11:30, everybody's wilting and they'll be closing up. So come early, enjoy it. We have a party in the courtyard. We've got bounce houses and stuff for the kids. All the mission tables will be set up, and you are invited to participate by supporting all the missions of this church. So I want to point a few things out to you. Wilson Elementary, that's a new one for us. This past fall, we supported them with shoes at Christmas time, but we've usually put all of our energies into Dover. Dover is still doing well. In fact, Dover Elementary now has a lot of corporations that are supporting them. So we're just going to slightly shift. We'll still be doing some things at Dover, but we're slightly shifting over to Wilson. That's a Title I school. It needs our support. And so we will be supporting them. We've got Echo and Outreach and Family Promise. All the monies that come from this event for Family Promise will not go to the Family Promise of Hillsborough County, but will go to this church, because we are in a state now where we need to replace a lot of our supplies. It's time to buy some new supplies that have grown very old. And so all monies collected will go specifically for our campus, so we can replenish and refresh all that we have. Zambia will be doing scholarships again in uniforms, Children's Home Cornerstone, Quilters Corner, and of course our food pantry. So next week, you'll get a written copy of this so you can make a decision what do you want to support, and then you'll be ready on the 21st. But on the 21st, you'll need to come a little early to enjoy everything that's happening in the courtyard. Now, during this next piece, which you're going to love, this is our time of giving. So we've got baskets in the front and baskets in the back, and of course, these are the other ways that we can help support the ministries of St. Andrews. So enjoy this special piece by Charles, and thank you for your gracious giving.
Welcome all. Hello, can you hear me? Is it there? Hey, now you can hear me. I just want to say one thing. I've been a Christian, and I pray and I ask God for things, but then I forget to let God do it. This song helps reinforce that. have been a Christian for a while, and it seems my life's become a constant trial. But Jesus, oh, the joy you've given me is deeper than the oceans and the seas. Now on this journey of the Christian walk, His essence been more than religious talk. A fire's burning deep inside my soul about my Lord and His sovereign control. Less of me and more of You, and I don't care, Lord, if I'm one of Few. I want to love You with all my heart, and I don't want us to ever be apart. This longing in me is true. Less of me, more of You. Now slowly as I've come to know You, Lord, myself that brings discord. And if I want to come to know You more, sprout out on wings like eagles and soar. I love You, Lord, less of me and more of You, and I don't care, Lord, if I'm one of You. I want to love You with all my heart, and I don't want us to ever be apart. With all my mind and all my soul, I ask You, Jesus, to take complete control. I wanna leave my life behind, and I don't want a true life I'll find. Less of me and more of You, and I don't care, Lord, if I'm one of You. I wanna love You with all my heart, and I don't want us to ever be apart. With all my mind, oh my soul, I ask You, Jesus, to take complete control. I want to leave my life behind, 'cause I know we're this feeling in me is true. Less of me, more of You. Less of me, more of You. Less of me. Less of me and more of You, Lord. Less of me and more of You, Lord.
Please stand for our doxology as you're able.
blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures here below. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God, the source of all our gifts. Praise Jesus Christ, whose power uplifts. Praise the Spirit, Holy Spirit. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Please bow your heads. Merciful God, in this time of reflection and offering, we acknowledge our weaknesses and limitations, knowing that it is through our struggles that we learn humility and dependence on you. As we bring forth our gifts, may we also bring our vulnerabilities, trusting in your grace to transform our weaknesses into strengths for the work of your kingdom. Amen.
Please be seated.
So today, we're going to tell a story about a woman. This woman is so stunningly beautiful that two times in her life, her husband asked her to pretend that she is his sister because he's afraid he'll be killed because a king will want her. And in both cases, it probably saved his life at least. She is a woman named Sarai, which I'll be honest with you, I've always called her Sarai. Well, I've called her something different probably all the time. But the correct pronunciation is Sarai. And her name means princess. And she is actually the matriarch of the genealogy of Jesus Christ. She's married to a man named Abram, but she has a problem. And her problem is that she's infertile. She's not able to have a baby. And we know that infertility is a horrible reality in some people's lives, probably some of you in here. It's a pain that really can't compare to other things. But in ancient times, if you were infertile, it also meant you brought shame upon your husband and your family. It was a miserable way to have to exist in a society when you did not were you not able to have a child. So she is our Sheroe for today. You see, during the month of July, we're going to look at four different women who we're going to call Sheroes, women who are ordinary, just like you and I, but because they believed in God, he did extraordinary things in their life. He did extraordinary things. And so we're going to talk about them. We're also going to let this carry over into our Friday Connection. We have a blog each week in the Friday Connection. And those will also be about different Sheroes. so that you can learn about a lot. There's a lot of women in the scripture that we need to focus on. But before we get to our scripture, let me kind of bring you up to where the story is right now, where we're going to start reading. So, as I've said, Sarai is married to Abram, and Abram is special in that at some point earlier in their marriage, God came to him and made a covenant with him. And in this covenant, he promised Abraham that he was going to have many descendants. That's an amazing promise that God gave him. But time passed and nothing happened. She was still as infertile now as she had been. In fact, they had moved and relocated to a land that God had instructed them to, but it's been 10 years, 10 years of infertility. And Sarai is angry and frustrated and sad and really probably feels like God has dropped the ball. You ever felt that way? Like God dropped the ball? Yeah, because if we're honest, there are times when we all feel that way. And so Sarai decides, I'm going to take matters in my own hand. In fact, I'm sure she convinced herself, maybe God always wanted me to take matters in my own hand. I can fix this. And so she comes up with this plan, and she talks to her husband about it, and she tells him, you need to take on my maidservant, Hagar, as your wife. This is a good idea. Guys, I want to tell you right now, if the wife ever asks you to do that, that is not a good idea. Do not agree to that. That is a bad idea. And they would eventually learn that. But Abram agrees to it. And pretty soon Hagar has a child. And the child's name is Ishmael. And you think this would be better because Sarai is now able to help raise this child, but it didn't work. In fact, it made her more embittered. She felt more jealousy and more anger, and she felt forgotten by God. And this wasn't what she wanted. She wanted her own baby. And I'll be honest, she had an anger issue, and she got so mad one day that she was mistreating this woman, and this woman decided to just leave. And this is where God steps in, and he takes care of both of these women. And so I want to read to you from Genesis 17. God comes back to Abram, and he reestablishes that covenant that he had promised to him long ago. But then this time he says, I'm going to change your name from Abram to Abraham. And then he turns his attention to Sarai. And this is what he says. Genesis 17, verses 15 through 19. God said to Abraham, as for your wife Sarai, you will no longer call her Sarai. Her name will now be Sarah. I will bless her and give you a son from her, and I will bless her so that she will become nations, and kings of peoples will come from her. And Abraham fell on his face, and he laughed, and he said to himself, can a 100-year-old man become a father, and Sarah, a 90-year-old woman, have a child? To God, Abraham said, if only you would accept Ishmael. Remember, that's Hagar's son. But God said, no, your wife Sarah will bring birth to a son for you, and you will name him Isaac. And I will set up my covenant with him and his descendants after him as an enduring covenant. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So I honestly think this is the part of the story where we can both get pulled into. We've got this woman, and she is beautiful. We're told she's just spectacular. And then we've got this man who's had this promise from God that is fabulous, that God's going to bless him and give him many descendants. They would appear like they have it made, right? But they're both miserable. They don't have the one thing they want, the one thing they dream of. God has just not given them the only thing that would bring them joy. It doesn't make any sense. They should have it all together. They would look so good on Facebook, but in reality, they have a pain that doesn't go away every single day. They are hurt. That's something we can kind of relate to, I think. I think this is where we need to pause on these Old Testament stories and now talk about the theology of the story. When we're kids, if your parents took you to church, you probably heard the story before. But what we don't do with our young minds is always pull all the theology out of it. We don't fully get it, okay? So there's some theology we need to understand from this story. This is something. And what is theology? It's what we know about God. It's what we learn about God. And every Bible story should teach us something about the nature and the love of God. So what do we know from this story so far? Here it is. Nowhere in this story does God ever take away the freedom of human action. Do you hear that? Never takes it away. He never binds us up where we can't move and move our arms and move our legs. He doesn't do that. God is there helping and guiding, but he does not control history. Okay, we got a slide. And this is really, really important because we get this confused. God relates to history. He works within history, and then he guides us to the appointed end. He does not control it. You need to hear that. There's a lot of pop theology out there that says everything happens for a reason. That is not scriptural. It isn't. As much as that feels comforting to you, it's not scriptural. I'm going to read this again. God relates to history. He works within history, and then he guides it to the appointed end. He does not control it. Okay, let's go to the next step of our story because this is important. This next part of the story was really getting to my favorite part. So we hear that Sarah and Abraham, they live in the desert. They're nomads and they live in a tent in the desert. And one day they get a visit from three people. Now this makes us scratch our heads. It doesn't make any sense to us. But it turns out that this particular story, the ancient Israelites delighted in. They loved this. They weren't uncomfortable with it. Because the thing is, we're told that God comes in human form with two other heavenly beings and visits them for lunch. We don't know of other places where God comes like a human and does this, and so we're like, well, is it really God? We're not sure. It doesn't matter at this point. Three people come with an important message. This is something else we wouldn't catch. They come in the heat of the day. That matters. Little details matter in Scripture, and here's the reason why. When you live in the desert, you do not travel in the heat of the day. You rest in the heat of the day. That's what that's for. Now, we all live in Florida, right? So do we do our gardening in the heat of the day? No. You get up earlier, you do it late at day. I never walk in the heat of the day. We know to do it in the morning or the afternoon or the evening. Well, three people arrive in the heat of the day, this would be a signal to Abraham that something's up. This is a special visit. This is a mission. This means something. So he would have immediately been alerted to that. And the first thing he says to these three beings that have come to visit him is, I will feed you lunch, which really means my wife will feed you. And so in ancient times, when visitors came, women did not leave the tent. They were not invited to sit down and enjoy the company. And really think about it, company would be really important when you live in the desert, but they're not allowed to come. And so Sarah is in the tent, and she's actually listening. What else would you do? I'd have my ear up against the tent wall. And she's listening to everything that's being said because she knows this means something. They came in the heat of the day. And so I want to read this next scripture to you because this is so cool. Genesis 18, verses 9 through 14. They said to him, where's your wife Sarah? And he said, right here in the tent. And then one of the men said, I will definitely return to you about this time next year. Then your wife Sarah will have a son. And Sarah was listening at the tent door behind him. Now Abraham and Sarah were both very old, and Sarah was no longer menstruating. So Sarah laughed to herself, thinking, I no longer have, I'm able to have children, and my husband's old. The Lord said to Abraham, why did Sarah laugh and say, me give birth at my age? Is anything too difficult for the Lord? This is my favorite part of the story. It just is. I mean, it's an amazing part of the story because it's something that we can relate to. I mean, maybe you haven't battled infertility, but there's a lot of other things you can battle, right? There's a lot of things we can battle. I'll be really honest, when Charles Sain, he was singing a testimony. He battled all spring. David, you've battled all spring. Some of us battle. Suzanne, you and your daughters, you know battle. Sometimes life calls us to battle, and it's really hard. And sometimes we're like Sarah, and we laugh. I did some reading on the internet because I wanted to read stories of women that are infertile so I could kind of relate to Sarah. And I found this one article by a reverend, a woman pastor, and she battled infertility for 10 years and still doesn't have children. And she said this, "I think it's okay to laugh. If God told me today that I would have a baby, I'd fall over laughing. I've had 4 rounds of IUI and multiple rounds of IVF and at least 2 miscarriages and a lot of dash hopes. I'm pretty sure motherhood is in the cards for me, and I would probably laugh at anyone who told me that it was possible at this point. I can totally tell where Sarah's laughter comes from." I think this is the most relatable part of the story. Because if you've had to battle for a long time, it doesn't feel like God remembered you. It doesn't feel like God has, it feels like he's forgotten you. It feels like, what is the point? Why am I believing in God? Because sometimes it feels like he's absent. And I think we need to acknowledge this. God doesn't judge Sarah for laughing. He understands her laughter. Because sometimes all we can do is laugh. Because life can be really, really hard. Life can be really a struggle. And sometimes God feels far away. And God doesn't, he doesn't judge her. You see, because God is in the business of teaching us who he is. God is in the business of teaching us how much he loves us. Remember when we talked about those truths of God? God doesn't send the bad stuff into your life. He uses the material that's there. Now, knowing that, think about that. The material in your life, the stuff you battle, what's that one slide say? God relates to history, he works within history, he guides it to the appointed end, and he does not control it. That's important for us to know. But he works through the troubles in our lives. He'll teach us about faith in the struggles we go through. He doesn't forget us, he doesn't leave us. He's at work, and I just, trust me, he works really slow. But it's in that slowness that he transforms us and our hearts, and he makes us into people of faith, people who have solid faith, people who don't turn away anymore, people who love God regardless of how hard life is. That's the God we serve. Now, some of you are very logical, and you're saying, okay, but why would God ask Abraham to be the father of nations when he's got a wife who's not able to bear kids? Why would God not pick some guy who has a very fertile wife? God knows everything. But you see, God doesn't look for perfection. God doesn't look for the easy route. In fact, often he takes the opposite. I like what Nadia Boltz-Weber says. She says this: sometimes the fact that there is nothing about you that makes you the right person to do something is exactly what God is looking for. You see, it is in the unlikelihood when God moves and we get beyond an addiction, when we get beyond grief, when we get beyond struggles, whether they be financial or marital, or whatever it is, the child that's just making you crazy, when you get beyond that, you know what? You give God the glory. You don't take the glory on yourself. You are giving it all to God because you know you survived only because of God's grace. That's how faith works. I'd like to tell you it was another way and it was easier, but it's not. But he's faithful and he can be trusted. And he doesn't give up on us. And he doesn't get mad on us when we laugh or get discouraged or feel a little angry at him. He doesn't get mad. He loves us. He continues walking with us. He never leaves us. And here's why. Because nothing is too difficult for the Lord, and He can be trusted. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. It's appropriate now, we're going to turn to communion, because in communion we receive the grace that will help us when the journey is hard. Join me for the liturgy. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love for us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed in us your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through the prophets. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind. You set at liberty those who are oppressed and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. At the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, he gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is the blood of my new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and juice, and make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, with the confidence of the children of God, let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of one loaf. The bread which we break is the sharing in the body of Christ. The cup over which we give thanks is a sharing in the body of Christ. All right, here are our instructions. If you are a server today, come forward and we will get you set up. So what we're doing is when you come forward, there'll be four stations. You come forward and you'll be given a piece of bread and a cup, and you immediately partake of it. We will ask that you come down these aisles. You want to come down either the center aisle or the far end aisles. And then when you go back to your seat, use the two side aisles for that. And there are communion in your seat. If you do not want to get up, so you can take communion from the seat, they'll be right in front of you. And for those of you online, I will lead you through communion in just 1 second. Also, if you need gluten-free, there is a gluten-free in all the baskets, and so you can just request that, and we will hand that to you. So I'm going to take one here. So before we get started, for those of you who are online or if you're sitting here, go ahead and remove the very top of the communion, get your bread, and lift it up. For those of you online or those of you in here who are not able to move, this is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. Receive. And then take your juice, whatever you're using, everything works, or if you're in the building, receive the cup and be blessed. Okay, so now you have your instructions. You can come forward down the center and down the ends, and we will give you communion as you come forward. Will you join me for the closing prayer? Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Okay, you can either look at the screens or get out your hymnals. We're going to start with number 110. Fourth of July weekend.
He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He has loosed the fateful lightning of this terrible sword. His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on.
Well, we're gonna slow this verse down, okay? This is a very important verse, so.
In the beauty of the lilies, Christ was born across the sea.
One verse of 696.
Receive this benediction. Go forth into this day knowing that God walks with you through whatever you battle and that nothing is too hard for the Lord. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
America, America, God has shed His grace on thee, and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining.